Exactly. So welcome back, everyone. Thanks for joining us for this next session, which I'm very excited to be chairing. I'm looking forward to the talks. It will be about the interplay of cancer and immunology. And our first speaker of the session is going to be Michal Šmahel from the Laboratory of Immunotherapy referring to Prague, the Charles University of Prague, which we are all kind of attending virtually right now. And we are looking forward to hearing about overcoming tumor immune escape.
Hello, and thank you for introduction. And I do not work directly in Prague. My institute is near Prague. It's called BIOCEV. And you can see this institute behind me. So at the beginning of my talk, I will dissect its title a bit, and then I will give you two examples of our studies in animal models. Cancer. Everybody knows what cancer is. It's a terrifying disease that caused almost 10 million deaths in 2018. To find a cure for cancer, as already mentioned yesterday, the US President Richard Nixon declared the war on cancer in 1971. And what was the result of this war? We can see on this picture. From 1971, the number of deaths in the USA is still increasing. And does it mean that scientists are incompetent to find efficient cancer treatment? No, I think it isn't the case. And I will try to persuade you. This graph again shows increase in cancer deaths, this time globally. But if we consider population growth and population aging, we can finally see decrease in cancer death. But I must admit that this progress in cancer cure isn't very fast. So we can ask the question why. Why so many people die of cancer despite great effort to enhance the therapy? And the answer is simpler. Because of resistance to therapy, since cancer cells can adapt to treatment. And cancer can be treated by different types of therapy besides traditional therapies. Targeted therapy and immunotherapy are increasingly used for cancer treatment. In targeted therapy, great success has been achieved in treatment of chronic myeloid leukemia using imatinib, a tyrosine kinase inhibitor that can inhibit the activity of the BCR-ABL fusion protein that contributes to malignant transformation in CML. And using this inhibitor, the 5-year survival rate was increased from about 30% to 90%. So it's really great. But still some patients die because of mutations in the BCR-ABL fusion protein. In immunotherapy, we can also find some examples of significant progress in patient survival. For hematological cancers, T lymphocytes carrying a chimeric antigen receptor have been approved for clinical use. And for solid tumors, immune checkpoint inhibitors are increasingly used for treatment of different cancers. On the surface of immune cells, we have a lot of receptors and ligands. and some of them can activate immune responses, and some of them can suppress immune responses. And if we use antibodies that can blockade these suppressant receptors, we can achieve a therapeutic outcome of this treatment. Ipilimumab was the first monoclonal antibody that was approved by FDA in 2011. And this monoclonal antibody targets CTLA-4 immune checkpoints. And 3 years later, nivolumab and pembrolizumab binding the PD-1 immune checkpoint have been approved for melanoma treatment with objective response rate about 20 to 30%. It means it's about twice higher than the efficacy of CTLA-4 antibody. This figure shows the comparison of survival curves of classic chemotherapy and typical targeted therapy. And at the beginning, targeted therapy is more efficient because it quickly kills cancer cells. But finally, we have similar numbers of surviving people. On the contrary, the efficacy of immunotherapy can be similar to the chemotherapy at the beginning. But in long term, it can significantly increase survival, especially of those people that didn't respond to other types of therapy. So it's again great success of cancer therapy. Immunotherapy can be successful because immune system can recognize tumor antigens and kill malignant cells. According to the concept of cancer immunoediting, this elimination of tumor cells can be first phase of tumor development. And different cells of both innate and adaptive immunity are included in this elimination. However, if this process isn't successful, some tumor cells may enter equilibrium phase. And in this phase, new variants of cancer cells can be created thanks to genetic instability and immune selection. And finally, these variants may evade immune system by a variety of mechanisms that can also be efficient after cancer immunotherapy. And this escape mechanism include especially downregulation of tumor antigens and downregulation of MHC class I molecules that present these tumor antigens on the surface of cancer cells and thus can activate immune cells and can function as targets of these immune cells. And also production of immunosuppressive molecules like cytokines or some enzymes can induce tumor escape, which finally leads to low efficacy in clinical trials. Overcoming tumor immune escape is necessary for decrease of high proportion of patients that still do not benefit from immunotherapy. And in our laboratory, we attempt to develop clinically relevant mouse models that can help us to understand immune escape and thus enhance the efficacy of cancer immunotherapy. we developed these new models from TC1 cell line, which is MHC class 1 positive. And this cell line was derived from primary lung cells using oncogenes E6 and E7 from human papillomavirus type 16. And another oncogene was used, HRAS from human, which is activated by G12V mutation. After DNA immunization using gene gun, we can see nice effect of this immunization because almost all animals are protected from tumor development. But in some mice, late tumors can develop about 50 days after immunization. And before this tumor grows, we can see some small nodules that do not grow, but they probably represent equilibrium phase of tumor development. And in these nodules, genetic instability inside tumor cells and further immune selection of tumor variants probably caused the growth of tumors. So we decided to use these late tumors to derive cell line and cell clones that are resistant to immunotherapy. And we tested this resistance by DNA immunization. And in most human tumors, MHC class 1 downregulation is common effect of tumor development. So we first focused on this MHC class 1 downregulation, and from one late tumor, we derived clones A9 and D11 with low MHC class 1 expression. And I should mention that MHC class 1 downregulation can be either reversible or irreversible. While reversible changes are caused by epigenetic regulation of transcription, irreversible downregulation results from genetic defects from mutations. And both mechanisms can affect genes encoding MHC class 1 heavy chains, but also light chain in MHC class 1 complex, which is called beta 2 microglobulin. And these changes can also be in proteins regulating MHC class 1 expression or in components of antigen processing machinery, for instance, in LMP proteins of proteasome or TAP1, TAP2 proteins that transfer antigenic peptides from proteasome into endoplasmic reticulum. And we used flow cytometry to check MHC class 1 expression in our developed A9 and D11 clones. And because in the case of reversible downregulation, interferon gamma can upregulate MHC class 1 expression, we used these cytokines in our experiments. And we found lower downregulation of MHC class 1 expression in D11 clone in comparison with A9 cells, which are completely negative for MHC class 1 expression. And we also found upregulation by interferon gamma, which means that A9 and D11 clones achieved a reversible downregulation of MHC class 1 expression. And when we tested the expression of components of antigen processing machinery we found that expression of TAP1 protein corresponded to the expression of MHC class 1 molecules in our cells. And we also showed that this expression of TAP1 was upregulated by interferon gamma. So we concluded that TAP1 downregulation was responsible for MHC class 1 downregulation in our cells. And what is important in human tumors, TAP1 downregulation is also very frequent. So we can conclude that we derived cell lines that are clinically relevant to human tumors. So we can use this clinically relevant model for improving cancer immunotherapy. And this figure shows sensitivity of our A9 and D11 clones to DNA immunization. And it's evident that this sensitivity corresponds to MHC class 1 expression. If MHC class 1 expression is high, we have high sensitivity to immunization. And with the advent of the CRISPR-Cas9 system that can edit genes, we decided to prepare also TC1 clones with irreversible MHC class 1 downregulation by deactivating beta-2 microglobulin, which is a component of MHC class 1 complex. And we derived this cell line, which is deficient in beta-2 microglobulin expression and also in MHC class 1 expression. So we have both types of MHC class 1 regulation, reversible and irreversible. And in the case of this irreversible downregulation, these cells are quite resistant to DNA immunization. So even more resistant than TC1A9 clone with reversible downregulation. Macrophages are often most abundant subpopulation of immune cells infiltrating in tumor. And two basic functional states of and phenotypes are usually distinguished. M1 macrophages and M2 macrophages. And with respect to tumor development, M1 macrophages are bad, M1 macrophages are good, because while M2 macrophages can support tumor growth by suppression of immune responses, M1 macrophages can either directly kill tumor cells or they can activate NK cells that kill MHC class 1 negative tumor cells, or macrophages can also activate effector T cells that can kill MHC class 1 positive cells. And the advantage of macrophages is the fact that they can kill tumor cells that are either MHC class 1 positive or MHC class 1 negative. So maybe we could use these macrophages to kill tumor cells with different expression of MHC class 1 molecules. And these bad M2 macrophages can be changed into good M1 macrophages using immunostimulants. So we decided to use this effect to activate M1 macrophages and possibly to use this repolarization of macrophages for killing of MHC class 1 negative tumor cells. And you can see that TC1 tumors are full of macrophages, and these macrophages are positive for immune checkpoint called TIM3. So we designed a combination of immunotherapy, which includes activation of adaptive immunity using DNA vaccination, which activates cytotoxic T cells or helper T cells. Then we activated innate immunity using adjuvant, synthetic oligonucleotide 1826 carrying immunostimulatory CpG motifs. And this adjuvant activates macrophages, NK cells, and dendritic cells. And finally, we use inhibition of immunosuppression using antibody against TIM3 immune checkpoint. And this antibody should activate macrophages and T cells. But because this antibody didn't improve our immunotherapy, I will show only results with combination of these two therapies in further experiments. And this figure shows comparison of our immunotherapy against parental TC1 cells positive for MHC class 1 expression and cells with downregulation of MHC class 1. And we can see a reduction of tumor growth in MHC class 1 positive cells and also in TC1A9 cells with reversible downregulation. And we can see nice regression of tumors after immunotherapy, but this regression was only temporal, because after a short period of regression, tumor started to grow again. And these tumors derived from DB2M cells almost didn't respond to immunotherapy, or only weakly responded to immunotherapy. So we studied the cells that influence that anti-tumor response of our immunotherapy, and we compared TC1A9 tumors and TC1DB2M tumors, and we found that in A9 tumors, CD8 positive T cells, macrophages, and NK1.1 positive T cells contributed to anti-tumor effect of therapy. And TC1DB2M tumors, only NK1.1 positive T cells contributed to that weak effect. And in both tumor models, interferon gamma was very important for anti-tumor effect. And we tested also cytotoxicity of macrophages isolated from either A9 tumors or from DB2M tumors. And we found much higher cytotoxicity of macrophages isolated from A9 tumors. So maybe this low efficiency of macrophages from DB2M tumors can be responsible for low effect of immunotherapy in this type of tumors. And we wanted to improve the low effect of our immunotherapy. So we searched the results of our RNA-seq analysis of expression of thousands of genes inside tumors. And we revealed potential targets that can suppress immune response inside tumors. And we found four genes that we were able to suppress, which could suppress immune response in tumors. Two cytokines, IL-10 and TGF-beta, one enzyme, arginase 1, and one receptor of cytokine, CSF1. So we tried inhibition of these four proteins using either small molecular inhibitors or neutralizing antibodies. And we found improvement of immunotherapy only after usage of antibody against CSF1 receptor. But what is important, this improvement was long-term. We got a long-term regression of our tumors, but only for A9 tumors, because when we applied this immunotherapy for DB2M tumors, we cannot see any improvement. And I would like to remember a part of picture describing macrophages in tumor. And this part shows that M2 macrophages are dependent on this receptor that we blocked here. So probably this blockade of macrophages resulted in this high effect against tumor cells in this model. But in this model, we haven't got any improvement, as I already mentioned. Now I will show you the second example of our tumor model. And for immunotherapy, immune checkpoint, PD-1 is often used, respectively, blockade of this immune checkpoint. But in some papers, it was described that this therapy is often not successful because resistance. And this resistance was described both as primary resistance, it means at the beginning of therapy, but also secondary resistance was found during the therapy. And in both papers, they found mutations in JAK1 and JAK2 kinases that bind receptors for interferon gamma or interferons alpha and beta. So they suppose that these mutations in kinases JAK1 and JAK2 are responsible for resistance to PD-1 blockade. And because I showed you that interferon gamma is very important in our models for induction of immune responses, we decided to deactivate interferon gamma receptor and study this deactivation in TC1 cells. And this figure shows that this deactivation was successful because after induction with interferon gamma, we couldn't induce production of PD-L1 molecule, which is a ligand for PD-1 receptor, and MHC-1 expression wasn't also activated with interferon gamma. What was a bit surprising, if we injected that cells with inactivated interferon gamma signaling into mouse and then isolated these cells from tumors and checked expression of MHC class 1 molecules and PD-L1 molecules, we found expression of these molecules. So it means despite inactivation of interferon gamma signaling, probably other cytokines inside tumor could induce expression of these immune molecules. And we checked some cytokines that could induce this expression, and we check it in tumors and in cell lines, and we found that these cytokines are expressed in these tumors. And from these cytokines, we finally found that interferon alpha and interferon gamma, interferon beta, could induce PD-L1 and MHC1 expression in our cell lines without interferon gamma signaling. And we tested in vivo whether these cytokines can be responsible for induction of MHC class 1 and PD-L1 in vivo, and using antibody against receptor for this interferon alpha and interferon beta cytokines, we showed that these interferons type 1 can be responsible for upregulation of MHC class 1 in vivo. So then we used A9 cells and the cells with deactivated interferon gamma signaling to study the effect of PD-L1 blockade. And we found that even with tumors without interferon gamma signaling, PD-L1 blockade was still efficient. So it means we proved that mutations in interferon gamma signaling doesn't mean that this abrogation of signaling will lead to resistance to PD-1 or PD-L1 blockade. And to summarize our results, we derived cell clones from TC1 cell lines that is MHC class 1 positive, and we prepared a TC1A9 clone which has reversibly downregulated MHC class 1 expression thanks to immunoselection in pre-immunized mice. Then we use CRISPR-Cas9 system to derive TC1DB2M cell line with irreversible MHC class 1 downregulation, and we use also this CRISPR-Cas9 system for deactivation of interferon gamma signaling. And using this models, we showed we found combinational immunotherapy that was very efficient against TC1A9 tumors. And this immunotherapy consisted of DNA immunization, adjuvant, and blockade of CSF1 receptor. But this therapy wasn't efficient against TC1DB2M tumors, probably because macrophages in these tumors cannot be induced to efficient cytotoxicity. So probably in this type of tumors, we should find another strategy, maybe strategy based on NK cells. And finally, abrogation of interferon signaling may not worsen sensitivity to PD-1, PD-L1 blockade. And I would like to acknowledge my colleagues from laboratory that mostly contributed to this work, and also finding a foundation of our research. And I would also like to wish you to find proper way in your science, in your life, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this exciting talk. We have roughly 5 minutes for discussion. So who wants to go first? Please use the participants tab to raise your hand. Sonal, please.
Okay, thank you. Congratulations, very excellent presentation. I would like to ask, because you showed in the list of cytokines which are able to activate the PDL1, except the interferon alpha, interferon beta also, if I checked it well, the CCL2. So did you study the role of CCL2 in the expression of PDL1 and in the resistance of the tumor for the immunotherapy?
Yeah, our cell lines are very efficient in production of this cytokine. So maybe this is the reason why so many macrophages is inside in tumors. But we didn't find the effect of this cytokine on PDL1 expression. Mm-hmm. So we didn't take care about this cytokine more because it didn't influence the expression of PDL1. So I cannot say if it has any effect on this kind of therapy.
Okay, so you think that the preferential interferon alpha and beta plays a role?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have any other questions or comments? Well, in the meantime, until we see more hands, I had a very tiny question from the beginning when you showed this graph and the aging population was declining. Maybe I was didn't have enough time to read the y-axis, but I was a bit curious, like what exactly do we see there contributing factors of the aging population and the cancer mortality and death rates? Oh, yeah, exactly. So is this just an increase of percentages on the y-axis?
Yeah, it's increase in comparison with 1990.
So that would mean we would have a less aged population since then?
Now, the average age is increasing. So it's necessary to consider this increase. And if we compare number of cases, let's say for middle age population, we can see better decrease of these curves than here. So it means if you have older population, of course, you have increased number of death for cancer.
All right, thanks. I think the Zoom interface was blocking the relevant information of the graph, but thanks again also for the explanation. That makes a lot of sense now. Do we have another question or two, maybe?
I would like to ask a question. I can't raise my hand, so I have to call myself. So I would like to ask you about the sort of what you mentioned that at the end of your presentation about the strategy based on NK cells rather than macrophages, because they don't seem to be as effective against the DB2M cell clones. I wonder, so this goes back to the part where you discussed the change of phenotype back from the M2 to M1 macrophages. So do you suggest that this is the way to proceed because they stimulate NK cells and NK cells can kill cells that do not express MHC1s?
Yeah, it's one possibility to try to get M1 macrophages in tumor, but maybe for some tumors, it isn't possible to change M2 macrophages into M1. So In that case, it'd be more efficient to eliminate macrophages in tumor, because we will eliminate M2 macrophages. And maybe this is also reason why we increase the effect of our adjuvant, because this adjuvant increases effect of M1 macrophages, and using antibody against CSF1 receptor, we can eliminate M2 macrophages. So maybe combination of these two strategies is most efficient for usage of macrophage modification in tumor.
Great, so let's thank our speaker again using the virtual clap.